Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Horror PSA presented by Scary Nerd. And as always, we are your hosts. I'm Paul.
I'm Saul.
And I'm Angie.
The following is a public service announcement.
The spirits of a deceased couple are harassed by an unbearable family that has moved into their home and hire a malicious spirit to drive them out. Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice. That's right. We're talking Beetlejuice this Halloween week.
That's right. Shake your titties. Yes. It's Halloween, kiddies. Let's get into this fabulous movie. You got Danny Elfman doing the score. You got Tim Burton doing the directing. Catherine O'Hara. Winona Ryder. Gina Davis. Fucking Alec Baldwin, Michael who plays Keaton. The president now. It's fucking bananas. Michael Keaton.
The best Batman ever.
How do you watch it? It was weird watching this movie and then seeing all these people. I'm like, how is that skinny, nerdy guy now a big fat dude that plays the president on SNL? And I'm like, how is this teenager now a middle-aged mom on Netflix every fucking, you know?
Yeah.
Like, who are these people? Like, this is my youth here on display. And I'm
it's
like,
so funny, though, because I watch this movie and I'm a child again. Like, all these people are I'm still a child, and Winona Ryder's still older than me as a teenager, and Gina Davis is still my mom. Like, I don't know. That just go right back into it.
Here's the thing that I got to say about this, about my childhood. The thing that I remember vividly watching before this movie, and you might be on the same page as me, was the cartoon. I lived, breathed, and died.
Yeah, ask if you guys remembered the cartoon.
I watched that movie.
The cartoon, every Saturday. The cartoon is what introduced me to the movie. So when I saw the movie as a kid, I'm like, where the hell is everybody? Like, where is Pierre the skeleton guy? Where's the, like, where are they?
Yeah.
Like, are they going to show up? Where are they? He's like, I know Beetlejuice and I know Lydia. It's like, where is everybody else? And I remember the parents being in there every once in a while. But I'm like, these are the people I remember. Where is the Netherworld? Where are all these things?
Yeah, so no, I was introduced. I was the same as you. I was introduced to the show first because I was two when this movie came out, maybe. So, I was definitely introduced to the cartoon first.
Yeah, not me. Yeah. I was the other way around.
You were the other way around?
I saw the movie first and then the cartoon. And
you were eight, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was a little older, I guess.
I was six. But still, though, I remember being like around 10 when the show ended in syndication, and I remember like I said, I lived, breathed, and died that show. I loved it. Mm-hmm. And then when I found out there was a movie, I'm like, I need to see this movie because I love the cartoon. And when I saw it, it was like a holy shit, what the hell did I just see?
Oh, it's so fun. I adore. I can adore this movie completely separated from the cartoon.
Yes.
And it's better that way. Like, they're better on their own.
It's because they're so different.
Make them so different.
The cartoon basically had nothing to do with the movie.
No, and it was like they went on their whole own adventures and, like, you know, did their own thing in the cartoon, and I completely dug it. Like, I dig the characters in the film, but I completely dug the characters in the cartoon too as a child. I was like, this fucking rocks.
Yeah,
we had the best cartoons.
And see the other thing too, the other movie that happened the same thing with me was with Ghostbusters. I remember living, breathing, and dying the cartoon, and then seeing the movie, and it's like, what is going on? Like, you're a kid, you're accustomed to seeing the cartoon, but once you get older and you appreciate the greatness of the movies, it makes everything that much better. But yeah, I agree with you, Angie. We had awesome cartoons when we were kids.
And, you know, funny story about Ghostbusters, I saw two first before I saw the first one or the cartoon. I don't know how happened.
I don't remember that, though. But yeah, let's get back to the awesomeness of Beetlejuice.
Yes, Beetlejuice. It's probably one of the most perfect movies, I think, that has ever been made.
Okay. I have to say a few things about this movie.
Okay.
First of all, it's weird seeing this as an adult and watching it and paying attention to it for the podcast and thinking back when you were a kid and watching and be like, this is the perfect kid movie because it's so random. It's so goofy and like just so much stuff happens, and it's like got a little bit of fright in there, and it's got, it deals with death and the afterlife in such a comical way that even, you know, kids can just not be scared of anything.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But then you watch it as an adult and I'm like, what was wrong with me as a child? Like, none of this shit makes sense.
No, I watched it as an adult and I was like, I love it. I still love this movie,
but none of it makes any fucking sense.
Okay, it does to me.
I do want to point out a few things. Okay. Before we get started into the movie. Okay. Because I love this movie, and I'm not shitting on this movie, because I do love this movie, and I will always love this movie, but this is how awesome this movie is, right? Beetlejuice was the first DVD sent out on Netflix in 1998.
Wow.
The very damn movie that Netflix ever was fucking Beetlejuice. So that's how amazing this movie is, right? And I'm going to go on a soapbox here, or I don't know what you want to call it, but Michael Keaton is the greatest actor in the world,
The best.
He was Batman.
He was Vulture. Yes, he was Beetlejuice. He was everybody. Okay,
Michael Keaton is our childhood, basically.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And the fact that, he got very little direction on the character from Tim Burton. Basically, according to the trivia, Tim Burton said Beetlejuice is having been lived in every time period but no time period. And Keaton used this as a jumping off point to create the character with such features as the shock hairdo, moldy makeup, and large teeth. He said that when he first showed up to the set as Beetlejuice, the crew was chanting, "Juice, juice, juice." This got Keaton excited for the role. One more fact. Michael Keaton ad-libbed 90% of his lines.
Holy shit.
This entire movie was all him. And the fact that they filmed all of his sequences at the very end.
So really?
They were already filming the movie before Beetlejuice was even cast.
Holy shit.
Yeah. So he was in there for like 2 weeks, I think, filming the whole 14, 15 minutes he's actually in the movie.
That's the thing that makes the most sense, because if you break it down, now that you're an adult, he is barely in this movie. And when he is in it, it's just memorable because you have everything that builds up to him being in there.
Yes.
And just all of his scenes are just what steal the movie.
Michael Keaton, we are not worthy. We bow down to you, sir. You are amazing. He's fucking Batman.
That's the thing.
And you know what? I was so concerned when he was in Spider-Man. I was like, how's it going to be? You know, because he was Batman. He was Beetlejuice. And you don't want your heroes to kind of come back and kind of like fuck that up in your brain. But I was like, fucking Vulture. Like, look at you. Yeah. Fucking threatening little baby Spider-Man.
Okay, and I have to say that, as kids from the 80s and whatnot, I feel like as that and as fans of Beetlejuice and, Batman specifically, when he kind of made his whole career resurgence when it was in that Birdman movie.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, oh, Michael Keaton. I'm like, bitch, we've known that since the fucking
Michael Keaton's been acting. Where the fuck have you been?
We know his range, man. We were there in the fucking 80s. Mm-hmm. Mr. Mom, man. I love that movie as a kid.
Multiplicity.
Oh, Multiplicity.
My peppy.
I think my favorite of his roles that not a lot of people watch was him in The Other Guys. Did you ever see that? Where he played the police chief?
I did see that. Oh, you're dragging it out of the recesses of my memory.
Because the thing that cracked me about it is when he's doing his, because he's the police chief and he's giving them their little rundown thing and everything, and he keeps dropping lines from TLC songs. Like, he's like, whatever, man, just don't go chasing waterfalls. And he just keeps doing that. And then there's another scene where he has a side job as the manager for Bed Bath & Beyond. And he's like, all right, guys, we need to watch out for this one guy. He's been raping a whole bunch of people, so just keep him out. And I was like, oh, wait a minute, I'm in the wrong spot. He's like, where am I today? I was like, oh, I'm here. It's like, don't worry about that. But, do worry about that, because we need to catch him.
All right, we love you, Michael Keaton. Let's get back to Beetlejuice and how amazing this movie is. So the movie starts off with Michael Baldwin playing with his little model town.
Just say Michael Baldwin?
And I even wrote Alec Baldwin. I pulled a Michael Baldwin. How did I do that? Because I was literally looking. Alec Baldwin. It's written on my damn notes. My brain just changes it, apparently.
Mikey Baldwin.
Mikey Baldwin. So the movie opens to Alec Baldwin playing with his little model town thing. And I love that this prop is so important to the film. It's so intricate to the whole story.
Well, that was probably like half the budget. So they're like, that's going to be most of the scenes. Goddamn.
But what it does so brilliantly, it gives, like, the ghosts are stuck in their house. So it gives you a whole other setting. And it gives you a whole other space
thing. You get to basically see the whole town without actually having to see any of the town.
Yeah, because like, you
see the hardware store and the bridge, obviously. And then when the dad's looking through and seeing like that other building or whatever, like that's really all you see. Like,
yeah.
It was like 90% of this could be filmed either on the set or, you know, the exteriors of the house and kind of shit like that.
Yeah. So did anybody else, like, what was the name of Barbara's sister? I forget her name.
Jane? Was that her sister?
I don't think that was her sister. I thought that was
her
just
sister
like,
or her friend.
I thought it was just her friend.
Yeah, I thought it was just the quote unquote friend real estate lady in this small town trying to get money or whatever, you know, to sell this
being
house.
Being an adult, seeing her come around and being a bitch trying to get them to sell the house.
Oh, man, says, I wrote Jane is a dick.
Yeah, it was like, this house is too big for you. Like, who fucking cares?
No, my note says, this house is too big for your no child have an ass. Jane is a real dick.
I wrote, my notes on Jane were, Jane sucks ass as a person and a woman.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but wait, I want to get to the opening shot. Why the fuck is Alec Baldwin, why would you have your mouth open with a spider near your face that close?
I don't know.
You're just asking to be...
Hey, we all eat spiders in our sleep. All right, we all eat spiders in our sleep.
And who the fuck gets someone a vacation present? Like, that's weird to me.
White people.
I guess.
White people with no kids.
White people with a big house and no kids.
Uh-huh. If you got money, you can buy presents for any reason.
Well, he has he has money for his... I wrote down Adam's in the basement with his toy Gandalfs.
But still, though, like I said, I don't like the fact that Jane was just being such a bitch. She's like, you guys need to sell this house. I got somebody from New York who hasn't even seen it and wants to buy it. Like, who fucking cares?
I know. She's
fucking
like,
house.
She's like, he's seen just a picture. She's like, Jane, don't send people pictures of our house.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck is wrong with you, Jane?
It's like, that is fucking ridiculous. And then Barbara kicks her out. And then what? She creeps up on Adam when he's in the basement.
Yeah,
when he,
through the window.
Pulls the
blood.
Like, he's
playing
with
his toy
Gandalf. What the fuck are you doing?
She's a creeper. No, I love how she comes back later and she's like, tell your dad I can help decorate. I decorated that whole house. Like, you don't need your help.
It's nothing to be bragging about,
but
Jane.
I love how she has such a little part, but she's such a horrible human. And
she is.
That's the thing that this movie has, and maybe that's why I liked it so much as a kid. It's very Hollywood, and it's very whimsical, but at the same time, it's very real. Like, these people, these humans, are very real individuals who you've seen throughout your life. They're just caricatures
people. They're caricatures to an extreme, to where it's like, I feel every character in this movie is memorable in their own weird, like, kind of just weird character way about them. And, like, it's like, why? That's why you remember, like, I think that's why it's so easy for you to remember all these scenes and all these characters and, like, what the little quips, like, Otho has with that other Chinese lady at dinner.
Oh,
and, like,
just
like, oh, is this another suicide attempt? It was, like, all those things. Like, it's just like you can remember them so easily because these characters are so just unique and different.
Well, let's get into, what is it, Adam wanting to take a trip into the town, and when they run into the old man, I love the old man, because he tries to get Adam to get a haircut, and then he just goes into a long-ass story about how some dude had his hair really, really long. And
I wrote it down. That, like, hair to his goddamn shoulders. just trim it a little.
I love how, like, Adam's just like, hey, Mr. So-and-so, walks into the hardware store without missing a beat, and that guy didn't stop talking. He's just going on and on.
He's just sitting there. He goes on his spiel.
His old barber
stories.
And when
Adam leaves, he's... Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when Adam leaves the hardware store, he's still on his little spiel. Like, he thought Adam was still sitting there listening to him. Was like, oh, he's on his... Like, he's an autopilot. I'm going to go do what I got to do, and then I'm out. He's on autopilot. I can't say anything else to him. I just love how Adam just does that, and he just goes back.
I love this whole movie. I love the little bridge that their car takes a nosedive off of. It's so, like, picturesque and little.
The only thing that I do hate about this movie, and I normally don't say this, but I fucking hate that dog for what he did.
I wrote down, you should have ran over the dog the first time, and then the second time, I was like, fuck Benji. But even as a kid, I'm like, that fall wouldn't have killed them.
No. They had to have not tried to get out
at
all.
That's the collision that their budget would allow.
So yeah, that makes sense.
Use imagination.
Here was my question on that, because, yeah, obviously the fall didn't kill them. And then I started thinking, okay, maybe they drowned because they couldn't get out of the car. But then you realize before everything happens, their windows are rolled
down. Yeah, their windows are down. They could have just crawled out the side.
Like, what happened? Did they get trapped? Because I didn't see them. This is, I mean, we're talking about the 80s. Nobody wore seatbelts back then.
Yeah.
So I'm like,
were they even mandatory back then?
Yeah, I know. Did that car have them? Like, are you sure?
Yeah, because we know they drowned, but how did they even try to get out? I don't know.
It didn't seem too hard, but again, no. Paul said it's what their budget allowed. I get that.
Yeah, and okay, and I do have to know, like, they did drown, and that's, you know, because I think they do say it at some point in the movie. Tim Burton decided not to just have them like wet the whole time, you know, because like everyone else has, like, you know, the means of their death, you know, kind of whether they're in the waiting room and everything. Like, and he was like, I just thought it would be annoying to the actors to just have them constantly wet for every scene.
That would suck.
Yeah. So he's like, yeah, I just decided not to with them and just kind of
amp
everyone else's, you know, kind of misery or death kind of a little bit more.
Yeah. So these poor white people walk home. And I've always loved the fingers on fire. That is that is an image burned into my brain. I've always thought that was so cool, because she says something about how she's cold, and I'm like, I'm always cold, so I don't know if my fingers would catch on fire. Like, as a kid, I always thought about that. I'm like, would they do that? And I asked adults, and they was like, well, your nails could burn, but I don't know if they'd burn like that. And so I've always kind of like, I need to do another experiment. Saul, we're going to grow your nails out.
No. We're not. Hey. No.
For science, Saul.
When you're buried in the sand, there's not much you can say.
We'll leave your nails out.
Won't be able to have you won't have access to my nails when I'm buried in sand.
Yeah, that's true. The fingers on fire was always cool. And another really cool detail is the handbook for the recently deceased. It's so cool.
I love how he reads it. I love that he reads it. He's like, the handbook for the recently deceased. Like, oh my God, do I have cancer?
No,
deceased, you idiot.
Deceased.
Imagine how like silly this movie would be if they were like a couple that was going through a divorce also, and like they just hated each other.
That would have been hilarious.
Yeah.
It'd have been like
that would have added another layer to the movie.
Like a ghost version of War of the Roses.
Yes. That's right. Who do we call about this?
I have always
nobody can die.
Loved the line, and I have used this line throughout my life when I've been reading something that looks just incredibly ridiculous. I always say this book reads like stereo instructions.
I didn't understand that as a kid, like, at all, like, what that meant.
I never did either, but I was like, that's a cool line. I'm taking it. Okay. And I have used that line throughout my whole life.
Now that we're adults, it totally makes sense. Like, this isn't very specific on what they want me to do.
Like, I could be looking at something in German and I would say it just because that's a perfect spot for it. It's a perfect line.
Stereo instructions.
Stereo instructions. But then we get... I love how they cut in and out of Beetlejuice, because like we said earlier, he's really not in much of the movie. We just get to see where he's at during different points of the movie. Like, we get a little cutaway to him sitting there reading a newspaper saying, let's see the business section. And he opens to the obituaries.
I thought it was funny that their pick in the newspaper is just a still shot of them coming in from outside from the previous scene.
I've always loved the movie stills as pictures. I've always enjoyed that, because obviously it's like all the art department. They're like, fuck, we need a picture of these people.
We didn't think of this.
I think they kind of layered the camp in this one a lot, because I was reading in the trivia that he didn't have a huge budget for like makeup and effects and stuff like that. So he's like, well, if we can't make it look good, let's make it look campy and just have fun with it. So
did
that's why everyone. I don't remember. I didn't look it up. She might have.
And V. Neal did all the makeup for this, and she's done makeup on literally everything. She did all the Hunger Games. She's done Pee-wee's Big Holiday. She's done the Amazing Spider-Man. Like every movie.
I think it's safe to say that any movie that Tim Burton's done, she's been on.
Yeah, pretty much. She's amazing. You'd know her work. Go through her IMDb. She's done a lot of makeup. And like when you said earlier that he came up with that moss effect, it's so executed well. I love the kind of like mold along his face. It looks so dirty and gross.
Okay. I have to get this out of the way. All right.
Okay.
Where the fuck does Beetlejuice come from? Not like where does his character come from? Where does his name come from? Because listen, okay, hear me out. No one in the movie ever says Beetlejuice.
No, they say Beetlegeist or something like that.
Because they get the thing. And okay, first of all, why is the movie Beetlejuice, like J-U-I, but then everywhere in the movie it's spelled like Beetlegoose with like G-E-U, right? And then they get the flyer. They get the flyer and Adam is like, Beetlegeist. And then all of a sudden they're there and it cuts to the scene where she just says Beetlejuice. And I'm like, who said Beetlejuice? No one ever told you that was that his
note.
Name.
Like, I made that note as well. Like, Kim, how did she land on that?
Kim and I were trying to figure that out too. It's like, why did they refer to him as Beetlegeist? Like in everything. And they call him Beetlejuice. Like, how do you translate Beetlegeist into Beetlejuice?
Yeah, it looks like Battelle Goose, basically.
Yeah. Because the thing that I don't get either is because, okay, the whole point is for him to get people to say his name for him to appear. The only thing I can think of is the reason why they have this is to be like, oh, this is the guy that we're not allowed to say his name, but if you see his name, you're probably going to say it. So if we put it this way, it'll get you not to say it.
That's how I reasoned it as a child.
So. Yeah,
that's straight up child reasoning right there. Yeah. That doesn't make any goddamn sense.
I was like, well, they can't say it. That makes sense. So they can't put it anywhere. No, that was my reasoning as a child as well.
Because even he, like, when he told Lydia, he was like, what's your name? He's like, I can't say my name. He's like, he motions the whole thing about trying to get Lydia to say his name. And he does that whole thing. But that would be my guess around it. Because what is it? When they talk to, what was the, I can't remember the caseworker's name.
Juno.
When they talk to the caseworker, she even mentions, him. But she never calls him by name either. And she says, don't say his name. Don't ever say it.
Don't say his name three times because that's how you call him.
That's what I wrote. Don't contact Beetlejuice, but this is how you contact him.
Yeah, it's like those, there was a Chappelle show where he's like the crackhead guy and he's like, we all know if you take $20, take the train down to 54th Street and ask for Larry, you can get some smack. I'm like, that's exactly what that was to the Maitland, basically.
Yeah.
Okay, here's another thing I don't understand. They tell them they were 125 years old.
No, they said they have to live there for 125 years.
Yeah.
They have to just be there in the house for 125 years?
Yes, that's how long they have to stay in the house.
Why? That doesn't make any sense.
That's their penance or some shit. I don't know. I don't know how the underworld works.
They don't explore this whole recently diseased book.
No, enough. And that's one of the things that I love about this movie is there's so many pathways you could go down, and my little child brain did. It's like, okay, so I wonder what's in that room of the lost souls. What would happen if a human went into the room of the lost souls?
Well, how would you even get there if you're a human?
See, I was like, okay, Lydia might be able to get there because she read the book. Otho might be able to get there because he read the book. So
Otho can't even change a tire.
All right, well, let's get to Otho because the deets move in.
Wait, I always loved the Room of Lost Souls.
Oh, I know.
That was the coolest thing.
Always kind of creepy. And as a child, you're just like, fuck.
Well, as a kid, I'm like, am I supposed to be afraid of these ghosts or feel bad for them? Because they're like,
I always felt bad. Help me. Yeah.
We're just floating in the air.
I always felt bad for them. I was like, no, poor little ghosts.
Death for the dead. Keep moving.
But the deets is...
What did that guy have to, like, what did he do in life that it was like, he has to just mop up the...
Silver servants, isn't that what Otho says?
Yeah, so
they must have committed suicide.
They all offed themselves, basically. So even the smash guy, he just stepped in front of the car.
Uh-huh.
But at least he's got a good attitude about it, because he's telling jokes and shit, you know, even though his 125 years of servitude.
Feeling a little flat.
Yeah.
but the deets has come in and start... decorating everything. Otho. What's Catherine O'Hara's name?
Delia.
Delia.
Mother. Delia.
D- Delia and Otho are running through this house saying, fuck that color, we're going to tear this wall down, fuck this old people stuff, we're going to basically do everything, because if you do not let me, I will go insane and take you with me.
The thing that I remember about Delia, Catherine O'Hara's character, I saw Home Alone before I saw this. So I'm like, it's the mom from Home Alone. Why is she being a bitch?
Catherine O'Hara is amazing.
Is Practical Homeowner a real magazine, or is that just a movie?
I think that's just a movie one.
No, because here's my thing. Because when I was a kid, there would be magazines, and I'm like, okay, that's a fake magazine. Like, I would ask adults, I'd be like, is this a real magazine? They'd be like, yeah, it seems like it's fake or whatever. And then for the longest time, I always thought, like, you know, magazines and movies were mostly fake, unless it was like Time or Life or, you know, one of those fucking ones that, you know is a real one.
I did that with Good Housekeeping. Totally thought it was not real.
Horse and Hound. I thought it was fake.
Yeah.
I always thought it was a joke. I'm like, wait, that's a real magazine. Oh, shit. People, what the fuck is it about? Horses and Hounds, obviously.
The one that I thought was weird was the Farmer's Almanac, because I forget what movie I seen that they had it in there. I'm like, wait, what? And when I actually saw one, I'm like, wait a minute, these things are real? I thought they were just made up things for movies.
And the Dietzes come in and the Maitlands are not happy, and they discover that they aren't really that scary. And Gina Davis has a line that says, what's good of being a ghost if you can't frighten people away? And I've always been like, that would be the fucking worst, right? Like, being conscious on some level and trying to, like, get these people out of your house and you can't do shit about it.
The thing that I love about Otho's character is when you get introduced to him, is he doesn't come in through the front door. He decides to come in through the fucking window.
It's bad luck, Charles.
I don't get
where he got that idea from, but I've never heard, okay, going through the fucking window.
No, he's so ridiculous. I love when Beetlejuice comes later and strips him into that, like, blue leisure suit yeah. And he gets all freaked out and runs away. I'm like, that's all you had to do to him.
he knew where to get him where it hurts.
The other thing about the guy who played Otho, what other movie do you connoisseur with him?
I know him from two movies, and this is one. Sleepwalkers.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good one. But the one I'm thinking is the only other movie that I know him from, and I always picture him from, is from Demolition Man.
Oh, that's right. I always forget that he was in that. And he's the same, because he's like that servant guy to the...
Yeah, he's the main guy.
Otho is pretty much the same character in that movie, too, because he's just whoever's little lackey.
He was just having those happy joy feelings.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Well, in Sleepwalkers, he was a dick teacher.
Glenn Shaddix is his real name. He's dead now, and they actually played the Daylight Come song. The one from this movie, they played it as like the last song at his funeral.
Aww.
Oh,
a little bit of trivia for you.
Wow.
But yeah, let's get back to the other thing I love about when the Dietzes move in is the movers just don't give a shit. They don't give a fuck. They're throwing stuff in there, and Delia's throwing a fidge, like, don't break my stuff.
I like how they just bring Lydia in on a couch or chair or something. Yeah, they're just like, whatever, put her here.
Like an Egyptian goddess.
Yeah.
let's not forget that Barbara straight punches the sandworm, because she has that thing where she tries to leave, and that's her first encounter with it, where even Adam's like, don't fucking go out there. You don't know where I was, man.
Yeah.
Like,
I think my favorite line of Lydia's in this movie is when she gets there and she says, Delia hates this place. I think I can live here.
Yeah. She is such an angsty teen, and I didn't notice it until I had to sit down and watch it for the podcast. And just because I probably never have thought about her as an angsty teen in my life. But like the way she's like, my whole life is a dark room. It's like...
We'll get you a dark room.
Yeah, it's like an over-the-top character of like a brooding teen. Like,
yeah, and I love it because she's always like looking off to the side as she's saying it.
I always laughed when at the end when she's writing her suicide note and then she like crosses it out, starts over, like, and then like that whole thing. I was like,
plummeted.
Plummeted to my death. Which later she did in Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Oh,
I wrote down that they complain about the Cantonese food, but then I was looking at, I'm like, what do you expect from a place called Duffy's Cantonese? Where are they? Connecticut?
Connecticut, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how good.
Oh, that's when Catherine O'Hara is wearing her glove hat.
Yes, the glove headband thing.
Like, fucking iconic. And she's still iconic in Schitt's Creek, man. Moira? Wonderful.
Now, the thing that I didn't understand is once they decided to remodel the house, is why there was like a, on the side of the house, it looked like there was
a
just,
little mini house thing.
Yeah.
I didn't get that either.
Yeah, just the two like ends basically.
Yeah.
I always thought like, yeah, what the fuck is like, even as a kid, I'm like, what is the point of that?
Yes.
And then there are half wicker chair things at the end. Mm-hmm. Like,
yes.
This is when it's remodel day, and this is when Adam and Barbara are in, they're looking out the window. And then all of a sudden, where did Adam get the ad for Beetlejuice? Like, it just shows up in his hand, and he was like, look at this. Like, it just
well, they
just
had a commercial like, at first. No, saw the commercial first.
I thought he had the ad first, and then the commercial.
No, they see the Bioexorcist commercial first.
Okay. I got demons running all through me. Yeah. Wow. And he's like, bring the kids. And I'm like, oh, that's sadly a dead kid joke.
Yep.
I'm like, I know that. Sure, you know, you didn't mean it that way because you're thinking, yeah, bring the kids. You know, have a great time. I'm trying to make some money. Like a used car salesman kind of yep. thing. But I'm like, this is a dead kid joke.
No, he is the used carsman. The used cars salesman of the Bioexorcist.
I used carsman.
I did read in the trivia that it was inspired by somebody around, I forget the state though, but there was somebody like that that he loosely based his little commercial on.
Oh, I'm sure there's been thousands of those throughout time.
Yeah,
there's a guy on YouTube where he was like the RV salesman.
Yeah, something like
weird ads like that.
But instead of trying to call Beetlejuice, they decide that they're gonna try to use the book. And so they say, if you need help, you got to draw the door, knock three times. I totally tried that as a kid. I was like, I wonder if it works. I totally did.
Where did they get the chalk from? There's I don't know where it came from. Like, all of a sudden, they're like, we need to draw a door. And like, all magically, he had chalk on his hand.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, maybe he had it up there in his, like, workspace or whatever with his toy Gandalfs.
But the underworld or wherever they go to, death's waiting room, whatever you want to call it, I fucking love that scene. I love all the little details of all the dead people.
The cigarette guy is my favorite.
The cigarette guy, the shrunken head guy, the choked guy with like the fucking food stuck in his throat.
Trying to cut back.
Shark bait is what I put because he had a big-ass shark on his feet.
The girl who was cut in half.
Yes.
Okay, I have to admit that with because she was like Miss Argentina or something, right? So she had like an accent.
The chick.
Yeah. The receptionist.
The receptionist. Yes. Yeah.
When I was a little kid, I didn't know if the caseworker was actually named Juno or if her accent was like Juno, your caseworker. So I wasn't sure until later. I'm like, okay, her real name is Juno. So it literally was Juno, your caseworker. Oh,
not you know your caseworker.
Juno, your caseworker.
I'm from Iowa, so I was like, no, her name is Juno.
Well, at a very young age, I saw Scarface, so I was like, okay,
makes sense.
Juno, your caseworker, man.
Makes sense, but like that's, I was so like confused. I remember asking adults about her little accident.
Yeah. Like, what happened to her wrist?
Like, how would you accidentally do that? I asked a lot of people.
Like, did she fall wrist first into something?
And then, so I learned about suicide.
There was a lot of, like, we've talked before about, like, how our generation, like, the parents just didn't really pay attention to a lot of stuff we were doing. And I was like, there's a lot of adult things in this movie that was probably, like, we asked... either ask questions or understood things probably sooner than we should have just because of like little shit like that in the movies.
That's why everybody's like, kids are so coddled today. It's like, no, we're just making it so they don't have to learn about suicide at the age of 4.
Yeah. Yep. I love how when they're going through the tour of, what is it? I don't know what other office that is. And we talked about earlier how they saw the lost souls, how they end up back at the house and like, wait a minute, this is our house. It's been redone. And Juno shows up and she's like, yeah, it's been 3 months. And I'm like, wait, it's been 3 months?
Yeah, it's like, well, hey, you've cut into some time into your 121.5 years or whatever.
Well, they were on, what was it, the 1 millionth, you know, ticket number or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to wait for a while. They didn't have an appointment. I know. When I was a kid, I'm like, it looked like it was like two minutes they'd sat there or whatever.
Yeah.
And then they got up and were like, oh. Take the hand back to the sixth door.
I forgot to go back just a little bit. I forgot that I loved how much or how they played up that football team with how stupid they were because they were dead and they didn't realize
that's
they were dead.
That's the second time.
Yeah, that's the second time they go to see
Jude. Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's what it was.
Now, this is the time where they come out and they talk to Juno, and then they do the designer sheet ghosts is what I call them.
Yes.
And I love how Adam is like, think of them as death shrouds. Like, those are death shrouds.
I know. I wrote down when they were ghosts, I'm like, why are you moaning? And not just like, get the fuck out.
I know.
Like,
and I love how Lydia thinks they're sex noises.
Yeah, she's like, knock it off.
I'm a child, for God's sakes. And I asked adults about that, too. You know I did. No. I was like, what is that? What does she mean? And they're like, oh, they just make noise in their room. But they told me about suicide, so yeah.
So it was like, well, okay, we answered one question today. We're not going to, that's two is too much. It's sex and suicide in the same conversation. This is too much for you.
They'd be like, just what change fucking movie are you watching?
Beetlejuice.
Just talking about Beetlejuice, baby.
And I love when they're trying to scare Delia and she just turns off the TV. Like, she gives no fucks.
How many little kids got that explanation about, like, oh, they just make noises in their room?
Probably every child.
And then heard noises later and were like, stop playing Beetlejuice in there.
Or just said the line, I'm a child, for God's sakes, and scarred their parents.
Yeah, I'm sure I've probably said that.
I have said that.
I know, yeah, I've probably said that as a kid, like, I'm a child, for God's sake.
And again, everybody in the 80s had Valium because Lydia says she's sleeping with Prince Valium tonight. Everybody was fucking medicated on Valium.
She fell asleep watching, was it wrestling?
It was wrestling, I think. Yeah,
yeah. You were watching wrestling.
I love how when Lydia starts taking their pictures and she starts talking to them, her first question is, are you gross under there?
Like, Night of the Living Dead?
I gotta see it. And she's like, you're not gross. You're just normal people.
I know. I always feel that too as a kid. I'm like, that would totally be me.
Yep.
And like the ladies.
What
like,
do you look like? I need to see.
If I was a girl, I'd be scared.
Why were you under the sheets? I want to know what's going on under there.
Mm-hmm. No, that's all she wants. She's just like, gross? Like, she just wants to know it. And I love when she tries to tell Delia about the ghost. Like, she completely just, like, blows her off. And she's like, let's try to play family just for tonight, huh? Like, she does it so, like, curtly.
That's always a memorable scene, just the way that she does it, her acting in that scene. Like, and I find it funny that, like, she has that scene, and then Lydia walks away or whatever, and then Adam and Barbara are like, well, what do you want her to do, Anne? I don't know. Like, they're so, like, we don't know what to do.
I know. I love. They're just stupid ghosts.
Nothing. It's like they're adults, but it's like they can't do anything. So, like, they're
they already are fucking up death. Like, when they went to the waiting room and they're like, you probably haven't even read through your handbook yet, have you? And then they're like,
we
didn't bring our handbook. And they're like, what the fuck? Like, the whole waiting room's like, oh, newbies.
We didn't know how to make a fucking appointment. Yeah, so it's like they're resorted to having to wait for this, you know, teenager to help them somehow, and that's like, that's like adds to their whole frustration of not only having to live with someone like Delia, but then, you know, not able to control the situation yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so they figure out Beetlejuice's name, and I love when they're just, like, put into the model all of a sudden, and they have to dig through the grave. And it's not a normal grave, it's all the pieces of the model.
Yeah.
I've always loved that. It's such a key detail that makes it, like, it just sets you into that whole setting.
Yeah.
And they pop the grave, and Beetlejuice the car salesman is born.
It's Betelgeuse.
Betelgeuse. Yes. And I love how he's always trying to molest Barbara. Like, he can't keep his hands off her. The first time he sees her, he tries to kiss her. Like, he's always touching Barbara.
No, he does kiss her. He does kiss her. He plants
her. And then he points his attention to Adam while he's, like, doing his hands behind his back trying to grab her.
Yeah. Oh,
that's the
scene. Yeah. I love that when he's like, we need to see some qualification. He's like, well, I studied a business Harvard school.
I attended the Harvard Business School.
What do you think? I love that.
He's like, I'm qualified. I love that his he's over the top and then he brings it back. He's like, do you think I'm qualified?
Yeah, he does. He brings it so, like, it's so well played. It's timed right.
As a kid, how many of you wanted to see the other side of when he's like, oh, what do you think of this? And he scares them.
All the time.
I'm like, wait, what is it? What is it? I wouldn't turn it around.
Yep.
Like,
I just want to see it again.
Apparently, they had something that they were starting to make for it, but then I don't know if it was budgetary or they just decided not to do it, but they shot it from the back instead and not gave you the full thing. So,
well, I think it works better that way because, like, it gives your mind
it does
the way,
because your brain's not, your brain's gonna make something that scares you, and that's the same way for anybody. So,
it's the Pulp Fiction thing of what's in the case.
Yeah, I suppose it was his soul, by the way.
Yeah,
it was what?
It was his soul
in the case.
Yeah, it was his soul in the case. That's what was in the case. You didn't know that?
I didn't hear what movie
Pulp
we're
Fiction.
Talking about. Oh, Pulp Fiction. Okay.
Well, yeah, Pulp Fiction, remember?
Gotcha.
Because I was trying to compare it to trying to figure out what the other side of Beetlejuice looked like, but like Paul said, it's pretty much open to anybody's interpretation. Like,
yeah.
In Pulp Fiction, what you think is in the case.
No, it's not what I think. It was Sissel.
It was Sissel.
Prepare to scour Earth for that motherfucker.
But Beetlejuice's little, his face thing, it always reminded me of one of the characters' Mortal Kombat's fatalities, where he takes off his, Cabal, where he takes off his mask and scares the shit out of people. I'm like, that's what Beetlejuice looks like to me.
See, Melina was always my character, so yeah, mask off with her big ass teeth.
This isn't the Pulp Fiction Mortal Kombat podcast.
This is our childhood podcast, okay?
I'm just saying, Paul, you said you always wondered what it was. And
hey, remember the
80s?
Yeah, this is... Okay, so back to Beetlejuice. I don't know how many times I recreated that, you're working with a professional here, and then kick over a tree and then say, nice fucking model. I did that so many times as a kid.
You grabbed your crotch,
I too? Did. I thought it was fucking hilarious. Even as a child, I was like, yep, that's my jam. I gotta recreate this scene.
The next time I'm gonna ride at Disneyland and it breaks down and I have to walk through it, I'm gonna try that.
Kicking over a tree on Snow White.
Kick over Snow White herself.
Nice fucking model.
Nice fucking model.
You're working with a professional here.
Sir, you are banned from Disneyland for life.
And
worth
Barbara,
it.
Like, Barbara's just making up shit as she goes, because to get out of the model, she's just like, home, home, home. I'm like, that wouldn't have worked. It's not
why
fair.
Not? Why not? Why wouldn't that have worked?
It seemed to work.
So how do you get out then? If that's the only thing, like, I didn't know either. I'm like, wait, how do you get out of there? Like, that's shit. What do you do? You can't really ask Mattel Goose because he's not going to tell you the truth. Goose.
The dinner party. Let's move on to the dinner party. We've already kind of talked about Otho's suicide jokes towards his ex.
Yes.
Wait, was that his ex?
I believe so.
I don't know.
They had like some weird sort of...
They did have that like ex kind of relationship thing. Like, why am I sitting next to you, son of a bitch?
Yeah.
Oh, you're looking quite fat, Otho.
My favorite thing about the dinner party besides the dance scene is Catherine O'Hara uncomfortably laughing. It's just everything. Yeah. Like, she's so nervous and
It's a little game.
It's a funny joke we have about ghosts.
Is she
like,
Irish? Just a wee joke we have about ghosts.
Yes.
Irish when I'm nervous.
And I love how she just starts singing out of nowhere. And like, everybody thinks it's a joke, but I love how they play it. They all play that scene so beautifully. Like, they're shocked that they're moving.
Yeah.
But like at the same time, they start to get into it. Like, at some point, they just let it go and everybody's into it.
So, Catherine O'Hara, who plays Delia, and Jeffrey Jones, who plays Charles. They are the ones that approached Tim Burton. Like, we feel this should be like a Calypso song to kind of just, you know, add to the comedy.
Yeah.
And since this was like a Geffen Pictures, I guess they owned the rights to this specific song. So that's how they kind of came up with using this song in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
But it was kind of their idea. Just like, we want like a, you know, Jamaican, like Calypso kind of just something, you know, like that. Because they were going to use something else like originally, but that was, you know, nowhere near this. So
no,
luckily
works.
That it worked out. So.
Yeah. Fucking works. The daylight comes and me one go home.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So what? If their plan backfires because they absolutely loved what happened to them and they're like, shit, what the fuck do we do now?
Oh, when Jeffrey Jones is dancing, what's his name? Charles. When Charles is dancing and they get to
the
blue
spider.
Tarantula. Like, he's so overly spider.
Like, it's like, it's taking me and I can't control it.
I love it so much. And then the little shrimp hands at the end. I've always, like, I have paused the movie to look at those shrimp hands. I love that detail of them grabbing everything. And I've always been like, well, how is it a hand if it's shrimp? And then like, I'm like, oh, it's a glove. And they're just underneath. Like, I figured out the whole like prop as a kid, and I was so into it. I love it.
But you gotta love, their plan failed.
Oh, yeah. They're like, let's watch them scatter. Mm-hmm.
Like, it didn't work. Like, they absolutely loved it. Like, oh, we got to do that again.
Oh, I love when Lydia comes up and she knocks on the door. And she's like, they want you to come down. You can wear the sheets if you want.
They're like, no, we're mad. It didn't work.
I love when she goes back down and tells Delia that they're not coming down. And she goes, please, they're dead. It's a little late to be neurotic. I love every character in this movie. They're so hilarious.
Yes. Yeah.
But then they go upstairs to find these ghosts because they will not take no for an answer. And Otho finds the book.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. While the Maitlands are hanging out the window to hide. I'm like, I don't think anybody else could see them.
I've always... I don't know. I guess they were hiding because they didn't want Lydia to have to, like, you know, lie or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I've always wondered, like, what would happen if they fell? Because, I mean, actually, they're not going to die. Would they just jump into Saturn, basically, again?
Basically, I would think. Like, they would fall to Saturn would be how I would kind of see it. Because they kind of, like, they fall off their porch or whatever out the doors into it. So I think that's kind of how it works.
Yeah, the thing that I didn't get... is that they didn't, why didn't they learn their lesson the first time by leaving their book all out and about for Lydia to find it? I'm like, don't you think you guys need to be more cognizant of where that thing is and just quit leaving it all around everywhere because now Otho had it?
Yeah, they're shit ghosts.
Okay, but you were a regular person, right? And then all of a sudden you fucking die and they're like, hey, here's his handbook.
You gotta study it.
Don't lose it. Like, you're going to just know what to do with this book all the fucking time?
You're dead. Now learn things.
Yeah, in a house that you have to hide into the fucking attic because you can't do anything else. Like, I don't know. Like, I would probably leave the book. I'd lose that book in the first fucking day is what I'm saying. If there's no, like, afterlife digital version or, like, I have a cell phone I can use in the afterlife, then there's no fucking way. I'm like, that book, I'm like, I don't know, what book? You guys gave me a book? I never saw a book.
Like, what book? Yes. Mm-hmm.
And then as they crawl back into the window, Beetlejuice laughs at them from the little model. And then he, by himself, goes after the Dietzes. He becomes the snake. They don't unleash them on the Dietzes. He just
come for
does
your
it.
Daughter, Chuck. Yes.
I loved the snake. The snake is so great. And like I said, I love that when he turns Otho into the blue laser suit and everything. I just love...
That's not the same scene.
Yes, it is. Isn't
no, it's
it?
Not. It's at the end where he gives him the leisure suit. And this one, he falls down the stairs because I wrote down in real life, Otho would have sued Charles's ass for Beetlejuice pushing him down the stairs.
That's probably true.
And then BJ goes on a bender in the model and crashes the truck.
He does.
And he inadvertently finds Dante's Inferno
room. Dante's Inferno room. Just Juno's idea.
Live nudes.
Mm-hmm. And then they're called back to Juno because Juno's pissed.
Yeah.
She's like, rule number one, never trust the living. And that's a good rule.
And I told you not to call him. He's like, and I thought of that just to get him in there to get you away because
the strip club was my idea.
Mm-hmm.
That's what she says.
Yeah.
But horror PSA, kids, never trust the living.
No.
That's where we see the football team. That's where the football team is just surrounded by the Juno is just surrounded.
I don't think we survived
that
crash,
team.
Coach. I love that the dead people are watching that scene in a movie theater as well. I've always loved that in the background. Like it's just like they're watching you. You're watching them. Like kind of weirdness.
Yeah,
it's always worked for me.
Yeah.
But this is also what while Lydia is writing her suicide note and crossing out words to be more flamboyant in her suicide note.
That's when you have Otho, Charles, and Delia outside in the weird roofless house portion of the model in the half wicker chairs. And I wrote down cool band name if anyone's looking for it, Otho in a Kimono.
That is a great band name. I dig it.
We are Otho in a Kimono, or if you're like a, what's that, emo kind of thing? Suicide Note Rough Draft.
Suicide Note Rough Draft.
Because of Lydia's next scene.
But Juno's like, you're gonna be scary. Now show me some faces. Get your game faces on.
Yeah, those weren't even scary. Because even as a kid, I'm like, that's not scary. Like, that's cartoony, man. Like, I know. I would laugh at that.
My favorite thing has always been the eyeball fingers with the glasses. Like, yeah, he's like trying to see.
He has to hold them up. Yeah, I always appreciated that as well.
I love
how she yells at them and says, you let them take pictures of you. You left your handbook behind. It's like, now you guys really need to step it up a little bit because you guys are fucking up pretty bad.
Yeah. And then Lydia goes up to try to find the Malins to tell him she's going to off herself. And she discovers Beetlejuice. And he tries to explain. And I love how he says, I'm the ghost with the most, baby.
Mm-hmm.
He's got that iconic line. And because that one was in the cartoon as well, the ghost with most. Yeah. And I loved his explanation about why he can't say his name. It's hilarious. It's like, you'll tell your friends, everybody will start calling me.
Next thing I know, I'm going to open shopping malls.
It's a whole thing. So if you could just figure out my name and say it without me telling you.
And then when he started pantomiming everything about how he was trying to get in, then she finally figures out, he's like, wait a minute. You were the snake.
When I was a kid, I was like, okay, juice, I would have got that. But I'm like, that bug, I'd have been like, I don't know what the fuck a beetle is. And like, I don't know what they look like. I'd have been like, bug. No, name a bug.
Insect?
Bug. No, bug. It's a name of a bug. Big bug.
Bug.
You're fucked.
Big bug. Little bug.
Roach?
It's roly poly?
I don't know. What do you? It's bug.
Like, but then rearranged faces, Maitlands scare Lydia. And she's like, I wanted to be dead like you. And Barbara has this line where she says, being dead doesn't make things any easier. And I was like, well, that's a horribly depressing.
I know. Like, wow. Thanks for that.
That's just, like, a
little 7-year-old. Like, so, I have nothing to look forward to. Thanks.
Is there a reason why Lydia wanted to off herself, or was she just being an angsty teen?
I don't know. I never got that either, and it kind of annoyed me as a kid. I'm like, why? Like,
I know. They didn't.
Then
really
you're gonna
explain
be stuck
it.
In this stupid house too, you dumbass. Like, what's the difference? Yeah. Like, if you want to get away from your parents, like, it's not happening because they're still gonna fucking be there.
Yeah.
And you're gonna be stuck in the, you know what, just the attic or whatever with the.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, I love
with fucking the Maitlands.
Barbara's line and be like, we can't even vacuum because it's out in the garage.
It's out
like,
the garage.
Oh no, you can't vacuum in the fucking afterlife, Jesus Christ, lady.
Well, that's because she was dusting. I'm like, bitch, sit down. Like, what are you doing, Dustin? You're dead.
Yeah, but see, that's the one thing I never... That's the one thing I didn't get as a kid, and I didn't get it now as an adult. It's like, why... I'm guessing she was just trying to be an angsty teenager, and she's like, she's miserable. But again, it's like, I just didn't get why she wanted to off herself.
Yeah, I never understood it either. But for new guests that have come into town, Maxie Dean, they're trying to get Maxie Dean to invest some money into the town. Yes. And so they've decided Otho is going to do a seance.
Yes.
With their old wedding clothes.
What am I worried about? Otho can't even change a tire.
I've always loved when they start disappearing, like when they're being called to the seance or whatever. I've always thought that was a cool detail, or like they're disappearing ghosts.
I love how when they do show up, how when they do disappearing thing and... Well, let me go back. I'm going to go back a little bit further. Is how they said, oh, we got to do the seance. And we don't, he's like, we need to find something of theirs. And then Barbara and Adam was like, good luck, because they threw everything away. And then for whatever reason, I don't know why, they decided to keep their wedding tux and what, the wedding dress?
I took that as, I don't remember if that was in the closet that was in the one room that Charles was like, just leave me this room. Because I always assumed, I don't know if it was or not, but maybe they just, like, you know, we'll throw that in there, like, whatever, who cares?
I don't think it was, because the office, I think it was just an office all by itself. That's what it seemed like to me, like, there was nothing else around it.
Yeah.
I always just, like, it took it as, like, maybe it was all still in the garage or some shit, and they just hadn't gotten rid of it yet.
Yeah, it was a trash pile in the back that haven't picked up yet.
Yeah, I haven't picked up yet. But when they do fill out the wedding dress and the tux, like, I've always loved the over-exaggerated, accelerated aging. And it kind of takes them into that ghostly looking thing like all the other ghosts in the room had.
They were going to be lost souls.
Mm-hmm.
So is that, that's one thing I'm trying to think of too, is like, were they turning into lost souls because they did something they weren't supposed to by letting them get the living, get the handbook, and that's why they got put in there? Because that's the only thing I can think of is why they were aging so quickly, and it looked like what Lydia said is like, they're dying, but like, can the dead really necessarily already die.
Well, the guy that they talk to about the lost soul says this is for this is the room of the ghosts who've been exorcised. So they were being exorcised through the seance. So that's why they would have ended up in the lost soul's room.
Yeah.
Yes. But when they start to notice that they're accelerated aging and they're like falling apart, they're like, Otho, stop this. And of course he can't. He doesn't know what he's doing.
You can't just read the book. You don't know what he's doing. Exactly.
So Lydia runs over to Beetlejuice's table and is like, you need to help me. And he's like, well, I'm kind of what you call an illegal alien.
Out, baby.
Yep. So he explains, to get out, we got to get hitched. So she's like, sure.
I'll find you someone.
Beetlejuice, 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 it's showtime.
Yes. And I love that because that was in the show too. Mm-hmm. It's showtime.
And I've always loved the end of it's like Beetlejuice's funhouse is really the whole end.
Yeah.
And it's such a fun, kind of like crazy scene.
And that is why I will not do two shows a night anymore. I just won't. I won't do it.
I love when he's like, I think we've had enough exercise for tonight, and knocks down the Maitlands.
I wrote down it was Beetlejuice Carson.
Yes.
See who we got here tonight.
I love when he pulls the comb out and he starts like combing his hair.
And then he gets like, it kind of like cuts and he's combing his hair and like it turns and like he's in that like velvety like tux thing.
Yes, and like, Lydia's all in her red dress. Yeah, I love it. Beetlejuice gets
met. The red dress is a favorite of cosplayers. I've seen that many a time.
It is. With the 80s hair, all that hairspray you got to. What's that called with the big bangs?
Aquanet. Yeah. I don't know. That's what I know. It's called Aquanet.
Well, the thing, what is it? I was reading the trivia. There's a reason for what is it, her being in the red dress, because it was that old saying, if you wear red, you'll end up dead or something like that.
Yeah, maybe, something like that. Probably because, I mean, so technically she would have been dead then.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But while Beetlejuice is running his funhouse, Adam and Barbara are slowly coming back around. But I love when they're like, Adam tries to say something and his whole fucking jaw falls off.
Yeah. Yeah, I always love that scene.
And then they're like, fuck, where is it?
Then the chattering teeth.
The chattering teeth is my favorite, and how he's teleported into the model. But we forgot the creature preacher comes in through the wall. I've always loved the creature preacher.
Whatever the hell he was, that little.
Yes.
That weird voice, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, then Barbara steps in and says, Beetlejuice. And he goes, eek, really loud.
Yes, that I've always loved that. Because it makes no damn sense. And it's just 100% just Michael Keaton doing whatever
ridiculousness. And then the mouth things that he throws on to Barbara. I've always loved the zipper. It always got me. I thought it was the funniest thing as a child to throw a zipper on somebody's mouth.
But to give her credit, she just unzipped it.
Yeah, she was smart.
And okay, you say it once, right? And he throws a zipper. Unzip that shit and go, Beetlejuice, real fucking quick, man.
Not exactly.
There doesn't have to be a pause in between them. Like, hurry the fuck up, Barbara.
But then he teleports her to Saturn. But the joke's on him because Barbara can tame a fucking sandworm, apparently. Okay.
I wrote down, Barbara tames a sandworm, crashes the wedding, and hops off the sandworm like nothing.
Yep.
Adam crashes the truck.
That's into Beetlejuice's foot. That's
it was like, okay, Adam, you got like 5% of that assist. And then it's like, oh, look, bitch, I just jumped off him. Like, hey, Lydia, what's up?
Yeah,
I just
Barbara carried the sandworm. Team. Barbara carried the team on that one. He eats Beetlejuice. The big sandworm eats Beetlejuice, rides off into the sunset with a full belly while all is well.
So does Beetlejuice get shit out and then just show up in the waiting room later? Or how does that happen?
Apparently. I don't know how you die and then you die. I don't know.
Maybe he narfled the Garthak and he won.
Maybe.
And he's back in the waiting room. Mm. Is he waiting for Juno? Who's his caseworker? I need to know these things. God damn it, Tim Burton.
But then... all is well that ends well, and Lydia's doing well in school, and now she wants her turn to dance.
I wrote this down. So is Adam and Barbara basically raising Lydia now, or what the fuck's going on?
It seemed like it, because
I thought they were all living there together, because if you look, half of the, they've now halved the house. Yeah. You can see where like the Dietz's style ends. And no, the okay. I wrote begin. Down,
is Adam and Barbara basically raising Lydia now? And I was like, okay, we'll give you half the house and you can just raise our daughter.
Hey, it's a fair trade. I mean,
yeah, because the thing is, you look about it, she comes back, she's been taking pictures of the town so they can update his model. And then they start asking her, like, how was your math test or how was your English test and all that stuff. Like, we studied really hard for it, but yeah, but to what Paul says, like, it seemed like they were doing Charles and Delia's job for them because they're the ones that seem more concerned about Lydia's well-being than her actual freaking parents.
Well, no, because Charles has that line. It sounds like somebody got an A on her math test or something like that. Like, so they all clearly know what's going on and what's happening, but maybe, like, that's just not their things. And the Maitlands never had kids, so maybe they're into all that stuff.
Oh, you want a kid? I mean, it's you know, it's not Lydia's, or it's not Delia's kid.
Yeah, so it's like, just, yeah. Charles got no nerves left.
We don't get along anyway, so... Okay, so in the eventual sequel, will BJ have a small head, a shrunken head, or no?
He better.
Or at least, explain it.
I've always loved the shrunken head because he comments on that guy. He goes, "Oh, is that your work? That's pretty good work." Like, why would you not expect the same thing to happen?
I love that he does that though. He steals a guy's ticket and he's like, "Wait a minute, you freaking asshole!" And he shrinks his head. And I love for me. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the football players come back to dance with Lydia into the sunset.
I don't think we survived that crash, Coach.
Rock your body on time.
Rock your body to Canada Day.
Yes. And that is the majesty that is Beetlejuice. We all love this movie.
We brought up the cartoon, and all I have in my head now is the French one. It's like, Beetlejuice?
The thing that I remember the most about the little... I think his name was Pierre, was the fact that he was always singing Alouette.
Yes, he was.
So I remember being a kid, singing that, and then having my music class and realizing, oh, shit, this is an actual song.
Mm-hmm. I did the same. The cartoon was amazing.
Yes.
They should put that on Netflix so we could show our kids that show.
Here's the thing. We bought the Blu-ray for it because we were surprised we didn't have this in our collection. And there were 3 episodes of it on the Blu-ray.
Hmm. Yeah, we had to steal this movie, this DVD back from our children because they had taken our copy and it was mixed in with their movies. So we had to go take it from them.
And we did see the complete series at Zia that we almost bought for the cartoon.
Nice.
Because I'm like, I need to get now. Now I'm kicking myself like we need to go back and buy that.
Yes. This movie is great. Everyone should watch it. It has everything that's amazing for Halloween. Like we said, this is our childhood.
This is you're going to hear this on a Thursday at the earliest. So you should have already watched this movie at least a few times.
Yes.
With Halloween coming up. So, And to anyone out there who's listening that doesn't celebrate Halloween, just watch Beetlejuice anyway because it's an awesome fucking movie.
Seriously, if you're in the UK or in another country that knows about Halloween but doesn't really celebrate it, watch Beetlejuice and you'll find how much fun we have with the darkness that is.
With the dead, basically.
With the dead, yes. We watch, Americans watch this movie every year. It like plays on a loop on some channels.
They show it on Freeform constantly.
Yeah.
Yes, this movie is the epitome of dark things that all Americans love. Go watch it. Speaking of which, though, we want to shout out to all of our newly acquired listeners from around the world. We have had lots of new downloads from around the world. We're so happy that you guys are here and are listening to us. If you haven't gone through our older episodes, you can listen to those because we have a lot of good fun ones in those past episodes.
We've got a lot of love lately on our 2001 Maniacs episode. That kind of went bonkers over the last few days. So if you listened to that one recently, thank you. And, I hope you liked it because we've got a lot of great stuff planned for us. We've got a lot of stuff. You know, it's been a year now. We've hit our anniversary finally, officially.
So if you have been here since the beginning, we love you dearly.
and send us an email. Say hello if you want some stickers, or we've got buttons now. We've got Scary Nerd buttons. We've got horror PSA and Scary Nerd stickers. So if you want any stickers or anything, podcast@scarynerd.com. Please just let us know.
Yes. And remember to always like, share, subscribe, review, you know, tell us what we're doing that you love. Tell us what you don't like. We want to hear from you at podcast@scarynerd.com. You can check us out on all the social medias, the Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We're on... You can support us on Patreon by going to patreon.com/scarynerd.
You can support us by telling your neighbor to listen to our podcast.
Yes.
Yes.
And then
tell your mama, tell your friends.
Tell your mama and them. We will be taking the first 2 weeks of November off because if you guys didn't know, in America, we're having a crazy election. So we're going to give ourselves a 2 week break and then come back with They Live. Because either way, things are going to be crazy. And then we'll be doing a couple other things in November as well as into December. We're going to be coming back to you with 2020 movies throughout the year. We're going to be reviewing and watching some of the great movies from this year. So if you guys have any suggestions, email us.
Email us or let us know. What was your favorite horror movie from 2020? There's so many that's come out. I mean, there's... a lot of stuff on Shudder and Netflix and things like that. Speaking of which, there is a movie called His House coming out on Netflix on Friday the 30th. We highly recommend that movie. It is equal parts of drama and horror and just it's crazy. It's a great movie. So give it a look. It's an international film.
From the UK. Matt Smith, Doctor Who is in it. So check it out.
A lot of fun for that movie. It's scary. It's scary. It's dramatic.
It's relevant. It's everything.
Yeah. It's a great movie. So check that out on Netflix. They don't pay us to say this, but it is a good movie.
But hey, Netflix, if you want to pay us to say some stuff,
yeah,
we're looking for advertisers.
Yes.
We won't mind.
So Netflix. But or anybody else who wants to give us money to advertise, we'll take it.
Either way, we're still waiting to hear back from Burger King, but I don't know. Either way, let us know what you thought the best horror movies of 2020 were. You please email us, podcast@scarynerd.com, podcast@scarynerd.com. We can't say that enough. So, let us know what you thought. I think we all love this movie, so we really don't need final thoughts other than to say thank you for the past year for me. From all of us here, for producer Kim, who couldn't be with us. Saul is actually in the quarantine room again. His in-laws are in town. Yeah. They wouldn't let him out of the house.
So yeah.
We had to do this over the phone again. Yes, for producer Kim and all of us, thank you so much. It's been a great year. We look forward to doing a lot more. So
yes, and we appreciate everybody who's ever interacted with us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. Yes. If you've listened, if you've downloaded one episode, we love you. If you've listened from the beginning, we love you. We appreciate that people are here to talk horror with us. And we hope that we bring you guys a fun time.
And all the people we've met at conventions and everywhere else. We've loved talking horror with you. We look forward to getting back to conventions whenever the hell the world gets its shit together. And we're going to be doing so much more. So thank you all from all of us.
Yes. And now. Yes,
thank you so much.
We bid you adieu. We will be back in 2 weeks. Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice. We're out.
Happy Halloween.
Bye.
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally.